let's talk about the Factathon. So, it's the inaugural North American event. We had 27 participants, 5 teams: Hackenblack, Cataclysm, Chainlink, Clash, and Little Boxes. There were 6 judges. There were 32 hours over 2 days. I will say that, no, there was no overnight. So people, we sent people home. If they worked overnight, that was their lookout. So out of all these numbers, there was only 1 first prize winner. And it was a surprise dark horse candidate. It was, in fact, punk rock legends, The Clash. Come on up, boys. Oh, wait, sorry. The Clash.
Darling, you got to let me know. Should I stay or should I... Thanks, Anthony. Next slide. Yep. Okay, so this is our team. We turned up first thing Monday morning, 8 o'clock, not really knowing what we're doing. I think between us, we have 2 hackathons previously. I've never been to one, and I'm not even a coder. So our team consists of Dan, Liana, and Praga, who are all from MBBJ, Timon from Silmon, and I'm from BIMtelligence. And previous to this, apart from the MBBJ, obviously knowing each other, we didn't know each other. And we all of us looked at what the topic was, what the theme was, sorry, which was generative design in practice. And that's what we were trying to find, a problem that would really suit that theme. And it was Liana who came up with the problem. And I've got to say, when she said what it was, that sold me straight away. That's what I wanted to do. So I'll let, Liana, I'll let you explain what we did.
Yeah, so in my career as a designer, one of the things that I've struggled with was resolving design conflicts, especially when it involved many other disciplines. So I'm usually able to come up with a few ideas on my own, but there's often ones that are overlooked because it's outside of my field of expertise. So not only that, we also need to consider the solutions and how it impacts the project in terms of time, schedule, and whether or not it's even viable. So if I'm supposed to come up with a good, timely solution without knowing all the possible solutions, what am I supposed to do?
I'm so glad you asked, Liana. We came up with a generative clash solver. It works in 3 parts. The first thing it does, you're receiving this XML data, right, from Navisworks, and we don't really know what to do. We've all been in that situation. So the first thing it does is it generates options of how the clash could be solved. Second, it provides a front end that allows users to select the optimal solution based on criteria that you've already decided. And third, it automatically updates the model inside of your Revit's discipline model on at home. We'll tell you more about that. Dan?
Yep, there is more to go. So basically we use generative design and machine learning to produce a multiple of solutions to begin with. So going through which way we can bend pipe or whatever we have to do. From there, those solutions were then pared down to a smaller amount, manageable amount of solutions that are put up on a web-based app, which is easy to use for people who don't even use Revit, so your decision makers can get on the app, pick out which solution is optimal for them, and then that gets sent back to the users to update in Revit.
Okay, while working on the solution, we decided to make sure that we use commonly used tools and tools that are readily available to anyone.
Next slide.
When you do a clash detection, there's hundreds or thousands of different types of clashes that can actually happen. And we decided to focus on one particular clash because, well, it's a 2-day hackathon, right? We only had a little bit of time to work on it. So the clash we decided to focus on was when pipes go through a steel beam.
So while we narrowed it down to a really basically simple clash, what happened is that solving a clash is never that easy. depending on where the pipe intersects the beam, there could be a multitude of solutions that are and not possible. There could be structural implications of whether you can really drill through the beam and get it out. So what you see here is possible scenarios and the beam divided into structural viability. The second thing that could happen is the kind of pipe that you have. Do you think I can go around it? Is it a gravity-based system? Do I need to maintain the pipe slope? Those kind of questions started coming up. So what we basically started with is four different pipes types, nine possible intersection scenarios that we saw in the last slide, seven possible solutions that cover each of these scenarios, and multiple phases of design. The metrics change for each solution. They change based on which phase of design and construction you're in. We're evaluating based on the cost on the project, the impact on systems down the line, or the project timeline. In these 2 days, we figured out that a total of 756 combinations were possible just for this clash. But only the options that are applicable and appropriate for the given case were generated. What happens next is the fun part.
Now it's time for a demo. So once we have all the data regarding the clashes, it's then sent to a web application which allows users who aren't in Revit or on site to view all of the clashes for the project and all the generated solutions for each. From there, you're able to see all the solutions and narrow it down based on criteria that's important to your project, whether that be time and budget, schedule, or just whether or not it's viable. So from there, once you've found a solution that works best for your project, you're then able to select it and submit it to our database.
So once for every one of your clashes, a solution has been selected on the web app, and, you download that in your session of Revit. So if you're a structural engineer, you're going to be receiving just the structural changes that were decided. If you're a plumbing engineer, you're just going to receive the ones that are going to tell you, for example, maybe to reroute your pipe. It's going to download not only that that clash is one that your discipline needs to solve, but then automatically change it based on the criteria that, you, for example, your project manager may have decided during clash detection. So that's where we made it to. It was roughly a prototype, but it was a great two-day thing. And Dan, you want to talk a little bit about the future possibilities?
Yeah, well, we're hoping that there are people that want to take this further. And if you do, it's a lot of work, because obviously this is just one clash, whereas we're talking thousands of different types of clash in a project. But the other future possibilities we've got listed up here, including code requirements, design criteria, client awareness, safety and design, landscape and infrastructure, all of those can be put through the same process to enable people, decision makers who might not have all the knowledge otherwise, to get a more informed decision.
So one of the things that we feel is important to state here is that it's really important for firms to start logging data. Data about the clashes that their projects come across, data about the solutions that they have put in the past, data about how it has impacted the cost and timeline for their projects. Maybe, you know, if that data becomes available soon, this is actually something that somebody can take forward and build it into something that we all use probably every day. Thank you all for listening to us. Thank you, DBI, for this amazing experience.
I guess we're going this way. We're going that way.